Okay, so welcome to the start of the course. So now you have an idea about the creamery projects, we're going to jump into creating the massing. In this course, we'll be working with Rhino 6, Rhino.Inside Revit, and Revit. We'll also be using the plugin Elephant quite a bit in this course. I used it a little bit in the previous course to this, but in case you don't have it, you can head to Food for Rhino and look up Elephant. It's this guy here. So if you just take a second to download that, if you don't have it, and just drop it onto your canvas and install it, we're just going to be getting into some of the components to make this process a little bit smoother. So if we come back to Rhino, in case you're jumping into this, this course is a follow-up to the first in this kind of wider series on Rhino.Inside. The first course was designed to production with Rhino.Inside. So if you haven't installed Rhino.Inside and you want to know the basics, please check out that course first and then come back here. In this class, we'll be creating, you know, some more advanced workflows for how to deal with larger buildings and more detailed aspects of, you know, modeling. In this class specifically, we'll be creating an initial massing script that we then use to go on and to create the facade. So we're going to start here in Rhino. Again, for those of you who weren't in the first class, my Rhino has like this darker setting, so you should be able to clearly see when I'm working in Rhino 6 as opposed to when I have Rhino.Inside open in Revit. Let's just jump into it. So I'm going to be working in feet here, and let's fire up Grasshopper to start creating the massing. And so the way that we're going to create the massing is going to be a slightly different way to how we did in the previous course. Previously, we completely scripted the building from kind of the origin of a point. In this case, we're going to script the building to a degree, and then we're going to bake it so that we can then manipulate that kind of geometry. So I'll explain that a little bit further down the course. But to begin with, let's just start with creating a simple floor plate. So I just grabbed the rectangle tool. Let's just keep the origin as the origin of my workspace. Let's keep this simple. So I'm just going to create what is the, you know, ground floor plate for the building. So I'm going to work with a rough floor plate of, let's say, that's the width of my floor plate. Let's say it's 60 feet wide. Of course, the beauty of parametrics is we can come back and change this. Actually, I'm going to get rid of that. And then let's go with a much deeper floor plate. Okay, so this is my building floor plate. So this is my ground floor. Here we go. Okay, so that's the beginning of our massing script. So, of course, we're going to try and keep this neat and have all our inputs on the left-hand side. I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to copy this down because what we're trying to do here is to create three rectangles, which are our floor plates, and we're going to loft those curves to create our overall mass. And so for the second curve, I'm going to make it a slightly different size floor plate. I'm going to make it a bit smaller. Let's go to maybe 90. Let's swap out this guy. We'll call this F2. Okay. So this is the beginning of our second floor plate curve. And we're going to have to move this floor plate. We're going to move it up and across. And so we're going to grab the move components and we're going to move it in two ways. We're going to move it, let's say, I'm just going to guesstimate here. Let's call it shift one. And we're going to go in the Y axis. Okay, so that's going to be our first move of our floor plate. And then we need one more. We're going to go maybe a little bit more. Let's go 60 feet in the Z direction. And of course, we can add these together to keep that in one movement. Okay, so then we have our second curve, and we're going to come back here and play around with some of these settings once we have our overall loft. We can go ahead and maybe hide that floor plate. Don't want to see that anymore. Okay, so we have two of the three profiles we need to create our overall massing. Let's keep this all nice and clean. So we're going to grab this one and we're going to move this floor plate just by in the Z direction. So I think the overall tower, let's aim for about a 350 meter tower. So let's just keep it simple. Let's say 300. We can see how the overall form of the building looks. And we're just going to move our third curve. Okay, so you can see that's maybe a little bit out of proportion. Let's make that like 100 and maybe bring that down a little bit. Okay, so yeah, we can play with this until we're kind of happy with the overall form. Let's just jump into full screen for our script. Maybe let's name some of these. So let's just call these height 1. And then we can do height 2. And maybe we could do a little bit of, you know, let's add a bit of maths function here. So we can at least keep an eye on what our overall building height is, just for reference. So about 300. Okay, looking good, looking good. All right, so let's grab our three curves. We're going to bring them together. We've got curve number 1, curve number 2, and curve number 3. And we're just going to grab all these and loft them together to create our initial massing. So you'll see, okay, that's looking super weird. And so we're just going to add a different option for the lofting. And instead of normal, let's go with loose. That should give us, there we go. It's a much more gradual loft. And then you can see we actually need to ramp up the shift of our building. There we go. So we see that these floor plate curves are not, you know, we're not referencing them exactly, they're guides, right? But they're determining minimum and maximum floor plates from bottom to top. So we have this initial loft, which is kind of our first mass, but we're not going to go with this kind of sloping facade. We want it to be kind of a vertical face for the actual facade. So we're just going to take this one step further and use this mass to intersect with some planes, which is going to represent levels. So let's go ahead and create some levels, essentially. Let's jump back into our script, and we're going to create a series. Of course, we could contour, but like I say, you know, it's very rare that your building has one uniform contour on it. So you can either create a list of elevations, which, you know, you might be getting from Excel spreadsheet. In this case, let's just say that, for example, you know, our lobby is 20 feet. Our typical floor plate is 15. And so we can also start naming these. It's always great to try and name exactly what you're working on in case, you know, one day your colleague might need to work on this and right before a deadline or something and they want to know exactly what's going on very quickly. This is how many floors I have. And then, of course, we can adjust this. All right, let's just add in. I don't think we need this, but I'm going to add it anyway. Let's just add in our 0, and then we'll flatten those guys. That's obviously representing our ground floor plane. So we have our elevations. So again, you can see we have a nice kind of set of inputs on our left. And let's just name these elevations. Level Ellie. There we go. That will do. Let's just offset the world plane by these levels. And there we go. We can see, okay, it's a good guess. We've kind of got the right amount of levels. So we can maybe, this was a little bit extreme, but you know, that's the beauty of this. We can come back and play with some of these settings. So we're going to use these planes to intersect with our mass to create our floor plates. So let's see, let's grab a plane and just name this level plane or something. And we're going to bring this up here. And let's use intersect, it's mathematical. The B-rep plane component should be great. So our loft is going to be our B-rep and our plane is going to be our elevations. Cool. And we're probably getting, I'm not sure why we're getting intersection failed, so I think that's probably the 0 or maybe the 1 at the top. There you go. That's not quite hitting our mass. We're not going to worry about that right now. That's fine. So now we have our floor plate curves. Great. Let's just name these floor curve. Let's keep it simple. Okay, and then we're just going to go through one more step. We're going to take these floor plate curves and extrude them. But of course, we need a little bit of maths to work out our floor to floors from our levels now, which shouldn't be too complicated. Let's bring this up here. And let's use the shift list. We're going to grab this list and shift it. We're not going to wrap our values. We're going to minus A from B. Let's just check what we got here. Okay, we got one left over. So how many? We got 20 curves and 20 floors. That's looking good. Okay, let's see. Let's extrude these curves in the Z. Actually, before we do that, let's go and turn our curves into surfaces. There we go. And a warning, curve cannot be extruded. I think that is, again, that's the, we've probably got a null hanging. Yeah, we've got a null hanging over from that plane that didn't intersect. That's fine. I'm not too worried about that. So we now have our curves. Let's just get rid of one. So at least our script. Oh, I didn't do it. I'm not too worried about that. Let's just work off this. Okay. So if we go and just look at, we turn the preview on. Ah, of course, I forgot to graft my extrusion direction. There we go. That's what I missed. Let's see if we bake that. What do we have? These are not closed still. Why is that? Ah, of course. I shouldn't have had my little curve component. There we go. Alright, so we've created our surfaces and then we've extruded up. And so now we have these kind of bounding boxes or this geometry for each floor plate. And so at this point, let's just name this floor massing. And this is where we're going to create like a break in the overall script, right? So this is essentially my initial massing script, you could say. So of course, I could just go ahead and hit the bake button like I did, and then we can start to play around with this geometry. We're just going to add one more step using the elephant components. We're going to grab the bake objects component from elephant. And of course, the geometry we're baking is a floor massing. It also allows us an input for attributes as well as a bake name. And then this is also a bake button. So you could connect a whole bunch of these to another button like this. It does the same thing. But we're just going to add some basic attributes. So we're going to use the elephant component here in a very, very simple form. And we'll get into, you know, adding some more complicated aspects later on. But under the attributes, we can give the geometry that we're baking some information. So we're going to get into the keys and values a little bit later, but that essentially allows you to store information in the geometry itself. We can set a Rhino name, layer, color, and also a material. We're going to use this in a very simple form. Let's call this floor massing. Let's keep it simple. So we're just going to use it to create a layer and put all our geometry on. And we're also going to use it as the bake name. And so we can go ahead and connect the attributes to the attributes and the bake name. So what the bake name does is this. It creates all the geometry that I bake will have this bake name floor massing. So if I go ahead and click the button, now you see my geometry is baked. What's great about this is I can now hit bake a whole bunch of times and you'll see there's no duplicated geometry. And this is what the bake name does is when you hit that bake or activate here, it searches your Rhino file for any geometry which has the name embedded into it, floor massing. It then deletes what's existing in the model and replaces it with what you just baked. Maybe a simple way to illustrate this is if I scale 1D, one of these boxes, right? This still has the bake name in it. So if I bake it, it's now deleted everything and replaced it. So it's super handy. especially, you know, it just streamlines. You don't have to delete things and then go back and then bake it onto the correct layer. This is kind of does that all for you. At the same time, you have to be careful that you are baking it at the right time because you don't want to lose maybe anything that you've done manually. So just keep that in mind. Feel free to connect this or disconnect this. If you disconnect it, then it'll just keep baking over and over. Okay, so what we've done is we've baked this out. So let's just go ahead and kind of close down our Grasshopper script for now. The reason why I've baked it at this point is because I want to create a gap in my process to enable me to create some manual edits or like some incremental kind of changes to the geometry. The reason why I want to create this is to let you as a designer to still have that control for some really specific or site-specific aspects of your building. And also, like I always say with scripting is you can get to 90% of what you want to do really quickly, and maybe that last 5 or 10% will take you ages when you could just, you know, maybe manually model it quickly. So what I wanted to just give you the chance to do is to just edit some of this geometry. So we're just going to scale 1D some of the lower down boxes to create this kind of secondary stepping motion. And for example, like this might be because I need this to be a really specific dimensions. Now, of course, this can be done in Grasshopper. I'm just saying that it might be really simple to just go ahead and manually make the edits because maybe, you know, the local building code stipulates that if this is over a certain distance, it's included in your GFA in a slightly different way. So you might have a really specific kind of distance that you're trying to work to. Also, it just gives you a little bit of that manual control over your design. So I just wanted to illustrate that. So go ahead and make a few edits to the model you have now, just to illustrate that you can have some kind of manual inputs into your process. And then let's grab a scale 1D to make one last edit. Let's go from here. I'm just going to say a little bit more. Okay, now, of course, we can make some, you know, for example, up here, this little step is not going to be realistic in reality. So this is where I might make those kind of little tiny edits that I know in the real world of construction, stuff like this would not be possible. So go ahead, make some edits. And then what we're going to do is we're going to start off a new kind of branch within our script. And maybe just to give you a sneak peek, we can use some of the elephant components. We can use the bake name to go ahead and reference that geometry. We could also reference by layer, for example. If you didn't use the bake name, we can still grab the layer. We can, you know, just make a copy of this. Of course, we can just plug that in, but just to make a really clear break between our script. So if I input the name here, also our bake name is the same as the layer name. So this is doing the exact same thing. But if I go to here and hide my geometry, you can see now I've brought that geometry, which has been updated by me, back in. Now, of course, if I want to make any major changes, I'd probably rebake the geometry and kind of do this incrementally. But I just wanted to illustrate that this is a way of dealing or adding in some kind of manual edits into your overall massing. So let's leave it here for this class. And in the next class, we'll pick up from this point. And then we'll then take this geometry and use it to start creating our floor plates and our facade. And of course, the crux of this, which is going to be our facade panelization, which we're then going to use to generate the geometry in Revit. So I will see you in the next class.